Mr. Tarrou, welcome to part two of three parts, where we're going to be discussing the fundamentals of finding the equation of tangent lines. This time, we're going to be finding the equation of a tangent line that is parallel to a given line. So we are not specifically told to find a tangent line at a point of tangency, a point that we're just given that is on the function. We are given a line that is not a part of our function, that it's somewhere out there on the Cartesian plane, and we want to find, in this case, maybe we don't just find one tangent line that is parallel to the given one for the function g of x is equal to x cubed plus 2. Now, there's lots of things we have to learn in calculus, but the less you memorize without reference to something else, the better off you're going to be. So this question here is asking for the equation of a line. So if you've never seen one of these problems, there's no need to stress out. Just remember the fundamentals from Algebra 1. What do you need to write the equation of a line? You need a point, you need a slope, and then you can put that into slope-intercept form or standard form if you for some reason wanted to start with that, or my favorite, I start with the point-slope form. So that's what we're gonna do. What is the slope that we need? What is the slope that we're gonna use to write the equation of this line? Well, I know this is calculus and I know that there's a function here and we're about to do some calculus to it, but this isn't the first time you were asked to find the equation of a line parallel to some other line. The difference between this question and calculus and maybe what you would have in Algebra 1 or Algebra 2 is, I could just give you a point and say, you know, give me the equation of a line through, you know, whatever, this point that is parallel to this given line, and you still know, hopefully, that all we have to do is put this equation into a form that we can easily identify the slope. And there's more than one way to do that, but my favorite is to go into slope-intercept form. So let's do yellow for one here, and we want to find, again, that slope. We're going to take the equation of our line, 3x minus y minus 4 is equal to 0. We're going to solve this for y, so we're going to add both sides by y, and we have 3x minus 4 is equal to y, and if you want to, we can write that as y is equal to 3x minus 4, just to make it really fit perfectly that y equals mx plus b. So the given line has a slope which is equal to 3. Okay, well, we're going to use that in a minute, but now we need to think about, you know, what is the deal with tangent lines? We have a cubic function, and I'm going to do a quick sketch of this situation here in a minute, but I want to make sure I don't run out of room. But we have a cubic function that is, you know, going to be changing. It's not a linear function. Its slope, its gradient, is always changing throughout its domain. We need to figure out how to find the instantaneous rate of change of this cubic function such that, or when is that instantaneous rate of change equal to 3? Okay, so we need to find and work with the derivative of this function because we need to find a point of tangency to which we're gonna run that line, which has a slope of 3, through. And giving you a little preview here, we might be finding more than one tangent line. So we can't know that point of tangency, that point that we're going to use with the slope to write the equation of a line, until we know where along the x-axis does that instantaneous rate of change equal to 3. So enough talking. Step two is, and we'll do that in orange, step two is we're still working with slope basically, but it's going to be working with the slope or the derivative g prime of x. We're going to take the derivative of g of x, which means we're going to take the derivative of the left and the right hand side. So we have g prime of x is equal to the derivative of a variable base and fixed power rule. We're going to bring that power down, so the 3 up front, we're going to reduce that power by 1, and so we're looking at the derivative of x cubed is 3x squared. Now we're going to move on and take the derivative of the second term of this expression, which is the derivative of 2. Well, like y equals 2 is a horizontal line, those have slopes of 0. Thus, that reminder that the derivative of a constant is equal to 0. Well, now we have a function, 3x squared, which is telling us the slope of our original function g, x cubed plus 2. Now we just need to find what is the x value such that the derivative, the instantaneous rate of change, is equal for function g is equal to 3. So we're still on the vein of finding slope, but it's like first we think of the slope of the line, maybe 2, we're talking about the slope of that function, and so we're going to keep working with this derivative. We have 3x squared is equal to 3. We're going to divide both sides by 3 and get x squared is equal to 1. Now we need to, of course, get rid of that power of 2 by introducing a square root. We're going to take the square root of both, the square root function of both sides. An even power of 2 and an even root of 2, the square root of x squared, that acts as an absolute value function. So really the absolute, the answer to the square root of x squared is the absolute value of x, which then is equal to 1. Your teacher, and honestly, I don't even show that very often. It's just a reminder, though, of like where is that plus or minus coming from when you take the square root of both sides? Well, it's from the square root of x squared acting as an absolute value function. So we have when x is either 1 or negative 1, those are two locations along the x-axis where our original function g of x has a slope which is equal to 3. Of course, we found that by connecting and setting equal the derivative of g to that slope of 3. Well, if there's two places along the x-axis where our original function g, or the derivative g prime of x, is equal to 3, well, then that means we're going to have two points of tangency, ultimately giving us two tangent lines that are parallel to our given line of 3x minus y minus 4. So let's find those point of tangencies. So step 4, we'll do that in blue, or I guess, well, step 3, we're going to find those points of tangency by, well, plugging an x value of 1 into the original function. So g of 1 is equal to 1 cubed plus 2, which is going to give us a point of 1 comma 3. And then we have g of negative 1, negative 1 cubed plus 2 is going to be negative 1 cubed is negative 1, plus 2 is 1, so we have another point of tangency of negative 1, 1. And just to double check that I'm not doing some kind of silly mistake, okay, now we're going to use each of those point of tangencies along with that that slope that we want to work with, that parallel slope from the line, that slope of 3. And find our two tangent lines. So tangent line 1, we'll keep that in, I guess we'll keep both in blue. Y minus y sub 2, y minus 3 is equal to 3 times x minus 1. AP is never going to be happy with the final answer in point slope form. They're always going to want them in slope-intercept form. So we're looking at y minus 3 is equal to 3x minus 3. Add 3 to both sides, and we have y is equal to 3x. Working off on our second one over here, we have y minus y sub 1, or y minus 1, is equal to 3 times x minus negative 1. So we're looking at y minus 1 is equal to 3x plus 3, and y is equal to 3x plus 4. So we have two tangent lines. We have that idea that we see this question, we're asked for the equation of a tangent line. Maybe the information is given in a slightly new format for us, but don't forget your basics. We found the slope of the line. We found the slope of function g in the form of g prime. We set that equal to 3. We found two values of x where the instantaneous rate of change, or the gradient of g of x, was equal to 3. And that led us to our two lines. We have tangent line 1. y is equal to 3x, and tangent line 2, which is that y is equal to 3x plus 4. So for a quick visual here, we have a standard cubic function, a parent function that you learned in Algebra 2 and pre-calculus, reminded of in pre-calculus. We have a cubic function that's been shifted up 2, so instead of passing through 0, 0, we're passing through 0, 2. And there's no vertical stretch on this cubic function. There's no leading coefficient other than 1. So it shifts around a bit, but over, if we're going to go over 1 and up 1, and over 1 and down, to the left 1 and down 1, if there was, say, a 2 out in front of this cubic, I would go over 1 and up 2, because 1 squared is 1, but then you double it. And our cubic function looks something like this. This is just going to be a sketch. A function that was an odd function. The original cubic function is symmetric to the origin. Once we shift it up 2 units, of course it's not, or anywhere off of the origin, if you will. We have tangent line 1, we'll do that in blue, where we have y is equal to 3x with a y-intercept of course, 0. So we're going to go up 3 and over 1. And we've got this line, which shows that I probably didn't curve my cubic function enough, but we have a tangent line here coming and intersecting at 0.13. And let me grab a yellow chalk here, or yep, there we go. The yellow one in our second tangent line is y is equal to 3x plus 4, same slope, just a vertical shift of 4. So up here to 1, 2, 3, 4, we have a slope of 3. So up 3 and over 1, maybe down 3 and over 1. And my cubic function's kind of showing like this as a secant line. So let me fix that. Of course, if you use a Desmos or a graphing calculator, there wouldn't be having to fix your drawing. But it's always a good idea when you're doing calculus. It's really important that you understand the relationship. And the reason why I'm doing this is it's really important for you through the course to get that deep understanding of what all these functions do and how they relate to each other is graph them. We have a function, we have the tangent lines, they should be just touching and looking like they're basically going in the same direction or parallel to that function at that point of tangency, where we just have that one instantaneous rate of change and that slope is constantly changing. If you have a function and you find its derivative, which I've now erased, it would be a good idea to take that cubic function and then right on top of that, maybe y sub 2, put in the derivative so you can see how the derivative function and the original function also relate to each other. But that is the end of our example. That is example number 2, or a second form type of question where you're going to be finding equations of tangent lines. In the third video, we're going to be finding the equation of a tangent line that goes through a point that is not on the curve. So it's going to be a little bit more involved because it won't be so easy to identify what the slope of that tangent line, what it needs to be. But for now, I'm done. I'm Mr. Drew. Bam! Go do your homework.